So if you have your Bibles, go with me to the book of Ruth. The book of Ruth. It's right after Judges. And you want to say, thank God we're not in Judges. Hallelujah. That we're in the book of Ruth. Now I want to talk to you about loyalty. This congregation today, we've been so blessed. We have so many among us who've been with us and with us who have been members of the military, both men and women, who have really given years of their lives to the military and have served our country so faithfully. And they've put their own lives on the line to help me and thee so many times. So I want to say to you, I am so thankful for the military. And when they pledge allegiance, when that group pledges allegiance to the flag of the United States, it basically means more to them, in one sense of the word, it does, than it does to you and I who have not made that kind of commitment, which can put your very life on the line for somebody else. And they understand loyalty lots more than sometimes you and I do. In light of all of that, you have to remember that for all of us, the Pledge of Allegiance is a declaration of our loyalty to this nation in good times and in hard times. So we're blessed to live in this nation, and we are responsible to pray as Christians consistently for our leaders, whether we like them or not. Just simply because that's what the Word of God says. So, what do I mean by loyalty? Loyalty is the quality of faithfulness to commitments or obligations. Let me say that to you again. Loyalty is the quality of faithfulness to commitments or to obligations, and it's faithful adherence to a sovereign, a government, a leader, or a responsibility. That's what we mean by being loyal, that you are faithful to your responsibility and what God has called you to do. In other words, a soldier stays at his post because he's loyal. A husband is faithful to his wife because he's loyal, and vice versa. A friend will keep your confidence because they are loyal. And God provided manna for 40 years in the desert every single morning for 40 years because he was loyal to his own. God is loyal to his own. Now, if you belong to him, you can shout because God is loyal to his own. The Bible says that the mercies of God are new every single morning. Because your Father, your Heavenly Father, is loyal to you. Look at your neighbor and say, we must be loyal. God is good to you, loyal to you on good days and bad days. When you act like a nut, when you act like an idiot, when you act like you don't even know him, when you are stupid, God is still loyal to you. God is an unchangeable God. The Bible says God is unchangeable. I am the Lord thy God. I change not. God is going to be loyal and faithful to you no matter what you do. But his loyalty is to his word too. And his word has put certain things in place. So he's going to be loyal to his word. And if his word says one and one, equal two, and this two means this, you go get this. Yeah, because God is loyal to his word. And it puts us to make choices about where we walk with the things of God. In Proverbs 26, it says this, many a man proclaims his own loyalty, but who can find a trustworthy man? So loyalty or faithfulness is not a matter of words, Solomon says, but it is an attitude of the heart. So it says loyalty is an attitude of the heart that you see by the person's behavior. That's sort of like a husband telling his wife he loves him, and yet it's the behavior that the wife watches. It's not the money that he slips to her. It's the behavior. She doesn't want to be paid off. You know, she wants to be of value. She wants to be loved and cared for and be of value to you. And for you to honor and be gentle to. Same as on the other side. You know, the husband doesn't want to feel that he's just the money maker or the honey-do person. But that he is of value to you. Now, one of the most inspiring demonstrations of loyalty in the entire Bible is found in the book of Ruth. That's why I had you turn there. So I want you to read, let's read together verse 1 of Ruth chapter 1. I'm reading from the New Living Translation. In the days when the judges ruled in Israel, a severe famine came upon the land. So a man from Bethlehem, which is, you know, the house of bread. So a man from Bethlehem, that's what Bethlehem means, in Judah, left his home and went to live in the country of Moab, taking his wife and two sons with him. Now, the events that we're going to be looking at here take place right behind the book of Judges. So you've got the last verse in Judges 21, verse 22 says this. In those days, Israel had no king, and all the people did whatever seemed right in their own eyes. And then the next verse is Ruth chapter 1, verse 1. So that's what we're looking at here. The time of the judges, things were chaotic, things were totally uncontrolled, things were absolutely, unruly, self-centered. I mean, things were a mess in the book of Judges. I mean, it was a uncontrollable society that you could get killed for walking out the door. I mean, everybody took the law into their own hand. Does that ring any bells with anybody? And so in that kind of encounter, this is where the book of Ruth comes in. You have to understand those background. You know the story. And we said right here, there's a famine in the land. And so a certain father takes his two sons, his wife and two sons, and they cross the Jordan, and they go into enemy's territory. They go into Moab. Be very careful when you're walking with the Lord that you don't decide to turn to the world for relief in hard times. So one funeral actually turned into three funerals, and all that was left at the end of this journey, all that was left, was an older widow with two younger widows and three tombstones. But in times of need, people have a tendency to do what they think they have to do. And so this family of Judah moved to a place where they would live among enemies of their own people just so they could get something to eat. Are you following me? In due time, the two sons married Moabite women. So we're back with Naomi. Her two sons ended up marrying two Moabite daughters. Well, people think that they were sisters. There's some theologians who believe that sisters married brothers, so to speak. Now, that was a very big deal. That was a no-no. If you're an Israelite, you do not marry a Moabite. Naomi's husband died in the land of Moab. Her two sons died there. There were no grandchildren. So Naomi is left alone with only two foreign daughter-in-laws. So that's where we stand. So Naomi then heard that the conditions were improving in Judah. Things were better back home. And so in that moment, she made a very good decision. She decided to go back home. Is anybody listening? Yeah. If you're not walking in victory, go back doing what you used to do when you were in victory. Now, do you know that God forgives those who make stupid mistakes? You know that, don't you? If you don't know that, I don't know who you are. Because we all are here, one stupid mistake on top of another, and God has forgiven us and made us powerful and mighty in the kingdom of God. When Naomi heard, her response was, I'm done with the Moabites. I'm leaving the Moabites. I'm going home. I've heard that God is moving where I left. I heard that something's going on where I decided to leave. God's moving there. So I'm going back to Bethlehem. I'm going back to my neighborhood, going back to my town. God's there. I'm going home. Amen. So let me say to you, disciple of the Lord today, if you're not where you used to be with God, go home. I mean, get out of Moab. Yes. Get out of the enemy's camp. Yes. Remove yourself from the temptation of the enemy and surround yourself with people of God. Yes. And if you can't walk out of the situation, then bring God into your situation. Yes. And surround you with Him. So that your house and who you are will serve God. That's for me and my house, we're going to serve God. Somewhere, well, the other half doesn't want to serve God. God's counting on you.
This is one of the most beautiful afghans you will ever have in your life. We wanted to open it up so you could see the full dynamics of it. I want to remind you that this design that the Lord gave me in an open vision back years ago in North Carolina, and with a dove flying through the air with healing streamers, the scriptures with on the healing streamers, it's just precious. I saw people loose their faith and turn it loose as they grabbed hold of this. We've already prayed over it with oil from Israel. We've already anointed it with the oil, and we've already laid hands on it. So many people have. And we've had so many reports where people were able just to loose their faith as they grabbed hold of it. Plus, it's absolutely gorgeous. It's a product for this month. It's wonderful. You'd want many a person to have it. I keep it on my bed. It's beautiful. And guess what? It just puts you in the presence of God, and you wrap yourself in the Word of Almighty God.
See, we're talking about, are we going to believe God or not going to believe? Who are we loyal to? Where are we? Now, Naomi, there was a few things that you have to consider when Naomi decided to go back home. I mean, it wasn't just let's jump in the car and go home. She'd been there a while. It was kind of embarrassing to go back home. It's kind of embarrassing to go back home and say you went and lived in the enemy's camp. You went somewhere and that your sons married people that God said don't marry. Right. You know, it doesn't matter what people say or think. When you and I learn that, life will be different. Yes. What matters is how we live. Right. It matters what God thinks. Yes. Not what Joe Blow thinks or Sally Sue thinks. It matters what God thinks about you and your call. Amen. And your walk with Him. Loyalty, good definition. Loyalty means doing what is right in the eyes of the Lord and being a person of integrity. Yes. Loyalty. Doing what's right in the eyes of the Lord and being a person of integrity. So Naomi departs. The two younger girls begin to go with her. And so that's where we pick it up, actually, in verse 8. But on the way, Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, go back to your mother's homes, and may the Lord reward you for your kindness to your husbands and to me. You know, I can imagine, you can let your mind go wild on anything. I can imagine she said, you know, y'all may be too big a problem for me to take back home. Come on, she knew what she was walking back into. She knew the judgmental crowd that the Jews could do at that point. Come on. So I can imagine her, and I'm glad y'all girls want to go, and thank y'all, hallelujah, but why don't y'all just go on back home? I didn't say that, but I can see that. Yes. It says, may the Lord bless you with the security of another marriage. Then she kissed them goodbye, and they all broke down and cried. No, they said in verse 10, no. We want to go with you to your people. We're going to return with you. This is both of them now. We're going with you. We're talking about loyalty. No, we're going with you. That's what we're doing. I mean, it's settled. That's what we're doing. Then you come on down. There's a pivotal verse that you need to mark, and it's in verse 14. And it says this, and they lifted up their voices and wept again, because she kept trying to make them go back. And they lifted up their voices and wept again. And Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. Instantly, I thought of another place in the New Testament about that. I thought about the kiss of Judas, and I thought about the clinging of Mary Magdalene. So each person here today, you need to make up your mind, and you got to decide, you got a choice in front of you, whether you're going to be a kisser or a cleaver. Start to title this, Kisser or Cleaver? What are you? Just blow a kiss or let, I love you, you know? Or do you hold on with a grip? I will not let you go.
Amen.
Reminds me of somebody else in the Old Testament. Who does it remind you of that would not turn him loose? Jacob. I will not let you go until you bless me. It's easy to give the Lord a kiss on Sunday morning. Give him a kiss of worship on Sunday morning. It's something else to cling to him all week long. We got a lot of kissers. The Lord is looking for cleavers, clinging people, people who hold on. It's one thing to commit to a person a ministry responsibility when it's easy and things are attractive. It's something else to be loyal and trustworthy when that commitment costs you more than it blesses you. And we'll say that again. It's something else to be loyal and trustworthy when that commitment costs you more than it blesses you. Going through a little hard time. Three things about loyalty I want to point out to you here with Ruth. Verses 15 through 18. Look, Naomi said to her, your sister-in-law has gone back. By this time, Orpah has gone back. So Naomi says to her, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. You should do the same. But Ruth replied, don't ask me to leave you and turn back. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. We've made this a marriage ceremony. That's not what this is. It's fine to use it, but it's not what it is. Wherever you live, I will live. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. I cannot tell you how many people I have married through the, not I personally, but have married through the years that vowed on their face before me, because I always asked the question, are you going to serve God? Are y'all going to serve God together? If not, I don't want to do this marriage. How many have I asked that question? You know, your people, your God will be my God. And I don't know where any of them are anymore. And they're certainly not together. Whatever, wherever you die, I will die. And there I will be buried. May the Lord punish me severely if I allow anything but death to separate us. Anything but death to separate us. So there's three things that has to do with loyalty. Number one, Ruth's loyalty to her mother-in-law was a choice. She didn't have to go with her. Are you listening? It was a choice. There's no such thing as forced loyalty, friends.
Amen. That's right.
Loyalty is a matter of the heart. Orpah kissed her mother-in-law goodbye, but Ruth clung to her. The word clung or cleaved here means to stick like glue, like super glue or white on rice. I mean, you're there. You're there. Naomi didn't demand it. She didn't ask for it. Ruth gave it from her heart. Ruth could have gone back to a life of ease. She may very well have married some Moabite and been somebody over there. But she didn't want to go back to that lifestyle. She didn't want to go back to pagan gods. She'd seen something in Naomi about her God that made her willing to step out of the enemy's camp. Now, that is what happened to Orpah, interesting enough. Jewish history says that she married a prince of Moab, and in time she became, get this, she became the great-grandmother of Goliath. The very Goliath that would be slain by the shepherd boy David, whose great-grandmother was Ruth. He has good things planned for you. Wow, man. So decisions we make in a moment of time affect generations of our descendants. The proverb, many a man proclaims his own loyalty, but who can find a trustworthy man? Are you trustworthy when your loyalty blesses you more than it costs you? And when it costs you more than it blesses you? Or are you just loyal no matter what? The Lord doesn't demand your loyalty. He invites it. He's not going to demand you to be loyal to him. He invites you to be loyal. Verses 16 and 17, Ruth says, do not urge me to leave you or turn back from following you. For where you go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. Thus may the Lord do to me, and worse, if anything but death separates you and me. Wow. A choice. Number two, Ruth's loyalty was unconditional. Whether it's comfortable or not, whether I like it or not, whether you treat me well or not, whether you respect me or not, this is my commandment, and it will last beyond your life. Even after you die, I'll stay and be buried where you are buried, Ruth said. I am not leaving you.
Yes.
Praise God.
That was loyalty upon loyalty to an ex-mother-in-law. She was a mother-in-law right now, but she's about to be ex. Because she's going to marry Boaz. But she's still mother-in-law. And you have to remember that Ruth was going into a society that most likely was not going to like her. She's a Moabite. Mm-hmm. They didn't like Moabites. Yet she says, wherever your God takes you, Naomi, wherever he takes you, I'm going to go there. Wow. Whoever your friends are, they're going to be my friends. I'm going to go there. I'll be there. God has some weird friends. Just look next door to yourself. But God is loyal. Not because you're great, but because God is trustworthy. Amen. Number three, Ruth's loyalty was a pledge to God. Yes. You shall be my God. God, your God, will be my God. You know, sometimes we get the idea that if I promise God something, I better be careful to do it. But if I promise another person, it's not really that important. We don't know anything anymore about loyalty.
Amen.
She gave up everything, and Ruth expected nothing. She didn't ask for a thing. Read it. Not a thing. Naomi was getting older. Ruth could become a caretaker. She didn't know what was in front of her. She didn't know what was going to happen. She didn't know. She didn't know what you and I know. We read the book. But Ruth didn't know it. And the book reads like a fairy tale. It's wonderful. She met Boaz, lived happily ever after, and she became the great-grandmother of King David. And ended up in the lineage of Jesus himself.
Yes.
A Moabite.
Yeah.
Wow. But she didn't know any of that when she made a promise.
No, that's right.
She kept it. When things went well, she kept it. When they didn't, She kept it. A pledge, listen to this, a pledge is not loyalty. Loyalty is what proves that the pledge was real.
Amen.
Church, we live in a society today that gives very little value to commitment and loyalty, to perseverance and dedication. Our culture is actually like Jell-O. It just has no foundation to it. Somebody tweets something, puts it on the internet, and all of a sudden it becomes a new law and a new rule. It's a new thing. You and I are called to be different. If you've committed yourself to the Lord and to His Word, don't you dare reduce it to just words, but let your life show it. Kisser or a clinger? Be a clinger, cleaver to the things of God Almighty.
Are you loyal? If you don't do anything else but stop and examine your life, examine your position. If you're going to a church, if you're a part of a church, are you loyal to that church? Or are you just like it when things are going great? Loyalty is when you were there in the good times and the bad times. Thank you for watching today. I pray that these programs are changing your life. Call us. Let us know how it's touching you. We'll love to pray with you and stand with you. Also, you can call and order the product for this month, the Healing Afghan. It is a wonderful Christmas present. And we are moving into a wonderful season because Jesus came. We didn't ask Him. He was not a gift that we requested, but it was a gift because of His love. We love you here at Sandra Kennedy Ministries. God bless you.
This is one of the most beautiful afghans you will ever have in your life. We wanted to open it up so you could see the full dynamics of it. I want to remind you that this design that the Lord gave me in an open vision back years ago in North Carolina, and with a dove flying through the air with healing streamers, the scriptures with on the healing streamers, it's just precious. I saw people loose their faith and turn it loose as they grabbed hold of this. We've already prayed over it with oil from Israel. We've already anointed it with the oil, and we've already laid hands on it. So many people have. And we've had so many reports where people were able just to loose their faith as they grabbed hold of it. Plus, it's absolutely gorgeous. It's a product for this month. It's wonderful. You'd want many a person to have it. I keep it on my bed. It's beautiful. And guess what? It just puts you in the presence of God, and you wrap yourself in the Word of Almighty God.